So, as already very nicely introduced, I will present something about new ways of calculation, maybe a topic for a follow-up of existing standards we already have. Standards we have are 20 years old, even up to 40 years old, some of them. And therefore, I think it's time to have something which is more fashion also related to existing, covering existing topics and problems as well. So, where I will start with is just a summary of the daily topics we have to cover somehow. Here you see two nice pictures, one is London, one is Moscow. You don't see a lot of classic rectangular shaped glasses or units there, or classic or old-fashioned skyscrapers. Everything is somehow bended, somehow shaped. With the skyscrapers, you are bringing in a lot of special loading. You have triangular, rectangular units. You have glass deflections, which are above standardization limits. From the load side, you don't have just wind or dead load or something like this. No, you have other things like thermal dilatation, maintenance load, even blast loads, snow loads, etc., which are acting on the glasses, and then, of course, as well to the structural glazing as well. From the material demanding side, the same thing. It's exposed to different temperatures. It's aging conditions, which are just seen on the two cities here, could be completely different. Then loadings as well. We are talking about long-term load, short-term load, and of course, all kind of combination out of it. Now, the big question is how to bring all of this topic into consideration of calculation, how to calculate these topics. Then, of course, some systems are existing. We have an IOTA ATAC 02, most of you knowing from Europe, or we have an ASTM C1401, which is covering mostly the American as well as the Asian part. But if you see this, just as an example for the IOTA ATAC, is by far not covering all of our demands we have. For the standard topics, it works well, but as soon as we are outside of this, we have some problems or topics or discussions how to demonstrate that adhesive itself will work over the required lifetime. So therefore, we need a more comprehensive engineering approach for the adhesive as well. And here, Valerie already mentioned this one. There's a working group now on standardization level, which is the working group 2 on the new or updated EN 15434, which will consider further demands of calculation as well. And what does it mean? It means that we have to adapt our system more to the needs of the real system. We have to adapt our calculation to the real system. And therefore, this just this generic safety factor we are using maybe is not workable anymore. Maybe we have to adapt it. And also aging effects, for example, aging effects in aging out of weathering, but also aging out of loading should be considered in the right way. And interesting is that with this topic, we are not alone. This is just an example. It's a German guideline, the DVS 1618. This is covering the calculation demands in the transportation industry. Railway industry is calculating joints according to this calculation, and they are working with reduction factors for all kind of loading. They are working with reduction factors for all kind of aging. They take into consideration the right load duration topics, and so on and so on and so on. And I think this might be a way, similar or somehow similar like this, to follow up with the topics in the facade or architectural world as well. Now, I want to go shortly through two topics. The one topic is reflection, or the better reflection of load duration acting on the joints or loads with different kind of load duration. The second one would be bending stresses. And for the load duration, just as an introduction, this is a system we know since years. We have all the values determined based on existing standards, but finally they are showing quite a kind of a black and white story. Either you have a permanent load forever, you are using this design strength, which is quite low, or you have dynamic loads. Good question, what is dynamic? But then you are using this kind of design strengths. But also here you have a dependency of strength on the load duration, but the question is, what is the reference load duration? What does it mean static? What does it mean dynamic? Because the adhesive itself will behave differently. Then, what strength to use for load different than wind and weight? Because this kind of values were created just for the determination of covering wind and dead load. And how to define the structural glazing joints dimensions simultaneously of different considering different load durations. Here, coming now to a picture that this should show how the reality somehow looks like. We have the topic of wind load, wind gusts acting several seconds onto the glass, then on the adhesive as well. You have the topics of barrier loads. You have topics of maintenance and climatic loads, which could act somehow days. Then you have topics of snow loads. Here we are talking about weeks in the most regions in the world. And dead load, cold bending, maybe permanently. On the other side, we have other extremes like blast loads, unique events. But here we are talking milliseconds acting on the joint. And interesting, just three examples, three different diagrams, is showing how the material, the adhesive itself, behaves differently depending on loading, depending on load duration. The first picture shows, at the end of the day, the behavior of a typical structural silicone under what does it mean if you act or if you put a different force under different time loads in. Then here, high-speed testing up to several meters per second, which might be important for blast events, for example. And then the same thing, fatigue. This is also a kind of underestimated topic. Here you see a strong dependency of the fatigue values or the fatigue on the performance values as well. So I think all of these topics have to be brought into the right consideration. You have to bring all the right things together. You have to take care that you don't mix up. Don't use fatigue values for permanent loads or vice versa. And therefore, you have to build up a new or amend the existing calculation methods. What is the task? The task is duration of loads must be identified, different time frames can be defined afterwards. Then we have to bring in all the loads which are acting simultaneously per time frame. And then finally, the stress in the joint can be calculated and compared to the load-dependent strength of the material. Now coming up to this theoretically. Here, just as an example, could be a glass roof, for example, where you have dead load, snow load, wind load acting on. And you see, with three loads, they have all different duration. The one is a permanent, the one is a kind of a mid-term acting on weeks, and the other one, the final one, just seconds, a wind gust, for example. Relevant time frames, quite easy. It's permanent, weeks and seconds. And then we are creating load cases out of this one. Load cases now considering just the permanent loads. Load case just considering all the loads which are acting on the medium level. Here, it's dead load and snow for this case. And for the last one, for this short-term topics here, all three loads are acting at the same time. And then, of course, you have to calculate the maximum stress level in the joint. Stress out of tension, stress in direction of tension and stress in the direction of shear. And then finally, you have to compare these values with the entire design strength of the material. And it's quite important that this kind of design strength values are all different. You don't use, for the comparison, you don't use the 2 weeks values don't compare the design strength 2 weeks with the max strength at 3 seconds. So you really bring the right time duration into the right combination. For, of course, finally you have to make a check, does it work, does it not work? And the idea is to bring it together like this, just checking the utilization level in tension, in shear, and of course in combination. For the combination, here the approach mentioned here is already one, the one mentioned in the ASTM 14.1. I was informed about it's called Sandberg approach. I never heard before, but seems to be. On an example, it means just very fast, very quick, insulating glass, outward sloped, 15 degrees, so at the end of the day, it's outside of a standard. Then with some other values for the climatic load, or might be important for the climatic load. And then, what does it mean? Again, as a repetition, at first checking the identification of loads and duration. Loads, we have the dead load, we have the wind load, and we have different kind of climatic effects acting on the joint, on the glass, and then, of course, on the joint as well. And then you see here that you have a permanent load, of course. You have the wind load, again, as a short term. Then you have some topics out of the climatic load which are permanent as well, like the altitude difference between production and installation, finally. But then the climatic load out of the temperature, for example, this is more a topic, could act on a day, on a daily basis. So again, a different time frame. Then, calculation, same as I have shown before, three different time frames, three different load cases, depending on time. And then, for each one, you end up with a certain dimension. And finally, it shows that for this particular case, for example, 12 millimeter as a secondary seal thickness would be the right value now. Now, coming to a second topic, I think Valerie, speaker before, already introduced this topic as well, is the topic of the consideration of bending. Because we are not living in an ideal world. We don't have just tension or uniform stress in the joints. We have also some other things. And therefore, we have to consider this one as well. And here the topic is, of course, the standard itself gives a good idea how to handle uniform stress in the joint. But, and then of course you can use this H specimen and you can calculate out of this one your design values and so on. This works quite well. But the reality is, in the most or more and more cases, we have bending acting on the joints as well. And here, bending or reasons for could be, of course, big glass deflections, for example. And secondly, of course, external bending moments due to special designs of frame or working with adapter frames and something like this. So the boundaries defined, they are existing, like with 3:1 or L100 as a maximum glass deflection. But the idea is that the joint itself must act more and more like a hinge. And therefore, we have to adapt our design topic as well. As already mentioned, possible reasons for this bending, big glass deflections or load eccentricities between adapter frame and mainframe might be a reason for. Then, of course, you have can calculate different kind of stresses depending on the topic you have. But the more important point is now the evaluation of the stress into the SSG joint. And here, I think this picture you have seen just two slides before, somehow in a similar way. We have this pure tension, the uniform part. And of course, this one can be compared quite easily with the values we have for the standard specimens, which were introduced over decades now. But the problem is what we are doing with the bending, where we can get values for the evaluation of the material for this problem. And the topic here is changing the concept of material information. We are calculating, or we try to calculate quite often with values out of this H specimen. But reality is that other specimens, dumbbell samples, for example, give a much, much better overview about the real material performance. Because the H specimen gives us information how the material behaves in a certain shape in a joint. But if you want to have information about the pure material performance, we have to change the specimen. And this kind of specimen brings us in a position to come very, very close. Even this one is not perfect, but it's somehow easiest to produce. But brings us in the position that this kind of... that we have the possibility to get real material information. And with this real material information, we just had done also an, for validation, we used a mock-up. We have made a bigger scale sample just to figure out we are right or not, because it's nice to have an assumption, but somehow you need also confirmation. And therefore, we had done a mock-up. It's a glass fin bonded into a U-profile. Based on calculation, then we should have a crack in the joint after around 40 kilonewton. Perfectly at this value, also the crack happens. And then comparing with the finite element calculation done for this mock-up, the high stress level, I think it's quite similar to the topics I have seen today already by John, also by Valerie, is somewhere on the corner, somewhere on the edge, you have some peaks in stress. And this one, for this material, fits perfectly to the values of the dumbbell samples we have made before. So it's what you see here is the stress level at failure was around 3.7 megapascal, and the material performance value at break on the dumbbell sample is 3.4. So therefore, it doesn't fit perfectly, but I think for a topic like this, very, very close. So again here, for the first three lines you already have seen before, but additional information here is for the validation itself of material performance, you still can use the standard specimens known since a long time. But for bending effects, maybe we have to switch over to other sample geometries which are reflecting the material behavior in a better way. As already mentioned at the beginning, this is now under discussion in a standardization committee on the European level. And I think input from your side might be welcome for sure, in order to have a kind of more, also some industry input or additional industry input into this topic as well. Summary, conclusion is that, yes, the modern architecture confronts us with some topics we should or must reflect also in future standardization topics. because living without, I think, is not a good idea or just bring a lot of confusion into a lot of topics. The method proposed might be one solution out of this one. Then this topic can be applied to much more systems than the standardization or than the calculation methods in the calculation methods mentioned in the standards already. And yeah, so we can use this one even for growing into the topic of review the design of the joints, I have to say, in a better way, or not more fashion, but in a better or definitely in a more realistic way. So thanks for your participation. And if you have any kind of questions, I think now is the chance.
Thank you. That's a very good presentation. If there are questions?
Hi, thank you for the very good presentation. What do you guys recommend for the failure criteria when you're doing like a brick model in finite elements? Is it principal stress? Is it von Mises or something more complicated?
That's a good question. I think it's principal stress. So, but I have to say here I'm not the specialist in this kind of question. I have to forward to my colleague, who's much better into this topic for this, and then maybe you can get, or she can for sure give you a better answer to this one. So I'm not so perfectly familiar with this finite element calculation.
You said that you want to find a better formulation to overlay the bending and the pure tension stress.
Yep.
Then you showed the glass which was clamped in between the U-profile, which produces mainly shear load. So, and I didn't really understand how you want to show that your theory fits, because its theory should fit on the bending problem, but you show the problem which mainly is driven by a shear load, because bending, I would have expected to that you bend.
Yes, you're right. Maybe I explained not in the right way. The topic for showing the example was more the validation of the right or how to check or which kind of test we have to use for the validation of a more complex situation. And in this case, it was a more complex. It was the joint dimension was quite big. It was in a shoe. There were also some horizontal and vertical bondings in. So the standard way of calculation doesn't fit. But the most interesting on this one was that the crack at first directly happened on the place calculated. And the crack also happened on the same value, comparing calculation with reality. So with this 3.4, 3.7 megapascal at the same time. So this shows that using this kind of material performance or the values out, material performance values out of this specimen, reflecting much better the reality of this more complex designs, or at, we are ending up at the stress peaks. Because this is the topic with bending, we have also stress peaks, finally. And therefore, we want to show that this will, we can bring this topic somehow into consideration.
So when so you had glued the glass on the side face, but also on the bottom face. So as you say, that you have a complex stress stage situation in the silicone. So under the tension loads in the silicone, how do you handle with those hydrostatic stress stages then?
Sorry, I didn't get...
With the hydrostatic stress stages under tension, if it's in a, if the, the silicone is a block, and then it's from three sides or from all sides, it's bonded either to the U-channel or to the glass, so you get a quite high hydrostatic stress stage in the silicone under tension load. And that makes that detail extremely complex. And I ask, how did you handle those stress stage situations?
I don't get the question. What do you mean with how we should handle this one? So we try to simulate this one. We are checking there's a maximum stress level. Where are the peak stresses? And then we are combining, or when we are comparing this one with the values we are getting out of the pure material.
What material law did you use to calculate those stresses then? So was it a Mooney-Rivlin, or was it completely different material?
No, Mooney-Rivlin. Mooney-Rivlin. Yeah.
Very quickly, looking specifically at a condition for insulating glass, curved units, we get very high climate loads, and to reduce the joint size that we specify, we'd like to look at using the movement of the silicon to reduce the rigidity in the system and the overall climate load.
Yeah.
Do you have a recommendation for the elastic modulus that you'd use for that initial movement? I guess it depends. I mean,
not on my hands, but here I have to say you have to be very carefully, because the one thing is maybe you can reduce the climatic load effects, but if you allow a certain elasticity between the glasses, then you end up maybe with durability topics of the insulating glass as well, as the butyl makes the insulating glass tight, and you have to take care that the butyl will not be affected by any kind of, or should be affected by very, very low movements maximum. So therefore, I think it's a feasible topic you are thinking about, but it's also a topic definitely should discuss with insulating glass manufacturers, because the topic of durability of the insulating glass and so on has to be considered as well. But the value itself I don't have on my hand, but we can discuss maybe in detail, more in detail.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Cheers.
Hi there. Did you like what you just saw? If you did, why not like the video? Drop us a comment below, as well as share the video with others, since GPD is all about sharing. And to receive more videos in future, subscribe and don't forget to click the bell icon for notifications. Ciao.